You my fry eating?
You spilled some right there on you. Right there.
Oh, I thought you meant my beard.
It could have got stuck in there. Alright. Alright, everybody. What? Should I do a different intro? Okay, I want to do something different.
Do something different.
I need to do something different. I'm tired of the alright, everybody. Alright, all you. No, I can't curse on this one either. Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Faces of Fear podcast.
You look like you're taking in the ass.
Oh, God. All right, we already started this one off rough. Anyway, welcome, everybody, to another edition of the Faces of Fear podcast. We are back after a long hiatus. First off, I want to apologize for not getting this one out sooner. I know it was supposed to be out in June, but let's just say I had a lot of stuff going on. And the month of June, I got to travel to North Carolina and visit lots of spooky, haunted places, which I will be talking about in the next episode of the Killer Instant Podcast. We'll be going to different haunted houses that I visited, different stories of the Asheville area. So very, very interesting topics and discussions we'll be having on there. But I promised you guys last month that we were reviewing the movie Chain. I said I was going to do it by myself, but guess what? I have successfully kidnapped Matt, the Bloodbeard Shope. What's going on?
Oh, I'm doing quite all right. How are you?
How does it feel to be kidnapped by me?
It's kind of hot.
Yeah, no, I'm pretty good at this, aren't I? You know, I just swooped you right up.
You just threw me in that van and drove off.
Yeah. So I used a taxi, you know.
Yeah, that's true. And I screamed the whole way.
So that's what we're talking about, everybody, here in this movie, Chain. Now, this movie is directed by Jennifer Lynch. And what's special about this, too, we're actually going to hear a little bit from Jennifer Lynch about the movie Chain. We'll have some of our thoughts about the movie, probably around the beginning or the end, whenever I feel like putting it on there. And we're also going to hear about some of her directing on Walking Dead and a Teen Wolf episode. Did you know she did that stuff?
No, I didn't know she did that.
Yeah. So I found out about that. So we have a nice little chat probably at the end of this podcast. But without further ado, we're going to get into this very interesting and intense movie called Chained.
Oh, wait. Tell them who her father is.
Yes, her father is actually David Lynch, which he's a very famous director. What did he do, that movie, Eraserhead?
Eraserhead, Mulholland Drive. Mm-hmm. He did Twin Peaks, the series. He did a lot of different really weird sci-fi distorted movies.
Yeah, so you're a little bit more on the more knowledge on the David Lynch than I was. I did see a couple episodes of Twin Peaks. I did like it. But the other movies I haven't seen yet. So, you know, I'll have to check those out soon. We'll probably be reviewing those. And he has his own kind of style. What's the David Lynch kind of style?
I guess his style would be the fact, like, he does movies that would seem like they're from a dream. And they have a story. They have kind of a story plot, but it just seems like the movie scenes are just slipping in and out of a dream world or a nightmare. And he does that because I think it's because he uses a special type of equipment that sends electrical shocks to his brain while he sleeps. And
well, damn.
Yeah, that's what he does. He really tells people he advocates for this procedure because he says it allows his creativity to come out more. And He's just a very interesting guy.
That is very interesting. We'll have to do some reviews about this man that I'm very interested in. Now, I did get to meet his daughter, which is also very interesting. But yeah, we'll get into this movie right here, Chained.
Hey, hon, it's us. We are in a cabin. We're on the way home. Love you.
Excuse me, that was our exit?
Mom?
I've got a child back here, and you're beginning to scare the bejesus out of me.
Oh, my God!
You will have one job. You do what I say. You clean up my house. You only eat what I've left in my plate.
This is your world. From now on, it is only me, you, and them. You will serve me for the rest of your life.
What's your name?
I'm Rabbit.
How long have you been here?
Since I was 9.
So pretty much we start off this movie, and then before we start this off, I want to let you guys know who's in it. It's actually the actor in this, the main guy, the main serial killer bad guy, to say, is actually Vincent D'Onofrio.
Vincent D'Onofrio.
Vincent D. That's what I'm calling him. Basically, he was in what was the series?
He was in Law and Order. There's so many.
Yeah.
Criminal Intent.
Yeah.
He was in Full Metal Jacket. He was in, recently he did, Jurassic World. He was in Jurassic World.
Yeah. He did. Yeah.
But his most people mostly remember him from Law and Order and Full Metal Jacket, where he plays Private Pyle.
Good old Private Pyle. But yes, he was in the Jurassic World, which me and Matt did see. Over the week, it was actually pretty sweet. But yeah, this is actually a very interesting role for this guy, because when he was playing in Law and Order, he was like the main guy that can spot out the serial killers. Like, he can kind of tell, you know, these like sick people in their head. He can kind of get into their heads and tell if they were innocent or not throughout the whole type of Law and Order show. So I thought it was very interesting to kind of see him actually play out a real type of person that he used to hunt down in a totally different show.
Yeah.
So it was very, very, very interesting. But the movie pretty much starts off with the...
which he does great, though.
Yes, which he does very, very excellently. We start off the movie by actually seeing this kid. And he's going through a bunch of stuff in like this like very modern day kind of like just plain looking house. With just a couple like weird furniture stuff everywhere. And he's going through a box that has a bunch of IDs in it. And he basically takes out an ID and he looks at it and he hides it. And then he hears like a knocking at the door, and he goes running up to it, and he counts to 10 as he's running up to the door, and he unlocks it. And then, bam, we see Vincent's character holding a girl, like struggling her and stuff. The girl's all crying and weeping and everything, and he just has her strongly by the arms. He just puts her into the room, and he shuts the door. Then we hear the screaming and stuff. Then we get the kid all upset. Then it cuts to a scene, I guess it says, of eight weeks later.
Earlier.
Cuts to a scene 8 weeks earlier with the kid and his mom, basically getting to the car with the dad. And then one of the scenes, basically they're saying like they're going to get a puppy or whatever, because the other puppy, I guess they had died. And the mom was really happy about the puppy coming because she knew like the kid wanted the puppy and stuff. So basically the dad drives her off to the movie theater and they go watch a horror movie together. And basically one of the lines that the dad says is like, oh, it's just in one ear and out the other.
One ear out the window. Yeah. Yeah.
And then the husband just insists of like, hey, you guys take a taxi. You know, I don't want you to take no train or whatever. And the girl's like, oh, I'll just take a train. He's like, no, I want you to take a taxi. Here's the money for the taxi. And then she's basically saying, oh, how great you are to us and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so then they get done with the movie, okay? And after they're done with the movie, they're trying to call for a taxi, and they finally get one. All right, so they go into this taxi and stuff. They're just chit-chatting about the movie or whatever. And then basically what happens was the taxi guy misses the turn that they said, and then he keeps driving off into the distance while the girl is pretty much cussing at him, saying she's going to get the cops. And then slowly and slowly and slowly, she realizes how much she's fucked.
Right.
Yeah. So she's doing all this. And then they finally arrive kind of like to like a field, like a big fielded place. And they stop at a stop sign. And then when they stop at the stop sign, the guy gets out and he just punches that bitch right in the face. It's like, damn, I didn't see that coming when I first saw that.
Yeah, he does it to quiet her.
Yeah.
Just to get her to shut up.
Quiet her good. And then he goes back into the car, drives up to his place. So then he basically gets his taxi. So that's how we first get the scene of this guy. He kidnaps his victim by using a taxi. Now, we're going to talk about that for a second. Matt, what did you think about that? That's kind of creepy, huh? Because when I watch this movie, I never thought, like, taxi driver, what the hell? That just fucked up. Well, you would never think of anything like that.
I mean, it's you know, it's original. It's a idea that really shows that, oh, you can't trust anyone. Because you think, oh, yeah, I'm going to go get in a taxi. I'm going to be all right. I'm going to go home. And not a lot of people put that thought in their mind that, yeah, there's another human in front of you who's driving the car, who has control of the car and could go anywhere they want to with you. And cops don't suspect it. Mm-hmm. No one suspects it.
Yeah.
Because you're a cab driver.
It was just like a non-expecting thing. Like, it's just something that's so normal to everyday life. Like, somebody, like, you know, especially in New York or places they were doing. Now, this place was shot and filmed in Saskatchewan, Canada. So, you know, that's just a normal day of life. So, basically, the mom's, like, crying for help and basically saying, like, you know, don't hurt my son or whatever. And she's just telling her son it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. So, the Vincent, he grabs the girl from the car and he basically just takes her and starts choking her and stuff and just slowly brings her inside. And then when we hear that, we hear a bunch of screaming, like, death screaming and stuff from the mom. And you just see the kid, like, upset and pees his pants and everything. Mm-hmm. So very, very intense scene right off the bat. Just to let you guys know, this is probably going to be like one of the most serious podcasts we're doing. I know we like to do a couple of jokes, but this movie was all no joking around. This stuff was pretty serious stuff, and it's pretty scary stuff because you can kind of feel like some of this stuff can happen.
It has happened, too. With the three ladies in, I can't remember what state it was, but the girls that were chained up inside the house for many years, 3 or 4 years, I think it was.
Yeah.
And had a baby through this guy. And he kept him chained up inside the house.
For a long time.
And then there was one, I think, in like Sweden. And there's always been, I mean, those kinds of stories have been floating around for years, like keeping someone locked up and caged up. But what's more interesting is that, you know, he locks up and he also kills.
Yes. And then basically what happens after he's done taking care of the mom, the killer, the Vincent, comes out and he looks at the boy and pretty much gets the boy inside the house. And he's basically telling this boy, like, hey, I didn't ask for you to come here and stuff. And I never wanted, you know, he's basically like a burden on me. But he basically lays down some ground rules to this kid. He's like, since I have you now and you're here, you're going to make me food. You're going to clean the house. You're going to, if you see like news stories of missing people, you're going to make them into my scrapbook. You're going to collect all the money from the people's purses. You're going to collect out their ID. You can't eat after I am. You can only eat my scraps. Basically just being, you know, basically the guy's servant.
I didn't ask for you. But since you're here, I'm going to make the most of it. You will have one job. You do what I say. You clean up my house. Garbage bags, mops, bucket, broom, they are your tools. Breakfast. You will serve me breakfast every morning for the rest of your life. You will not eat or drink anything without my permission. You only eat
after I have eaten. Only what I have left in my plate. You hear that? That means that I'm bringing one back. You have 10 seconds to open these locks. Every night, I bring home a newspaper. After I finish reading it, I want you to try and find stories about missing people. You cut them out nice and neat.
The licenses.
And you put them in the scrapbook.
Cash.
There was no phone in this house. The TV is off limits unless I offer it. If someone knocks, no one's gonna knock. If you steal from me, you get a beating. If you try and escape or you don't keep the house clean, you get a beating. If you make me nervous or get in my way at all, a beating. From now on, this is your world. It is only you, me, and them.
All right.
Servant and kind of like an animal.
Yeah, kind of like a trained animal.
Yeah, and he calls him Rabbit. He calls yes. Young Boy Rabbit.
Yes, he doesn't care about what other guy's name is before he's now Rabbit. So this guy has been christened Rabbit. And the kid is like 9 years old. All right. And then, first he kind of is a little resistant at first and stuff. So, throughout the movie, you kind of see like girls come in and out and stuff. He's very crying and stuff. And then eventually he finds like this little escape hole and he tries to get out from the little attic upstairs. He tries to get out in this little escape hole and he's just screaming his ass off. Help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. And the bad guy, Vincent, comes outside and saying like, hey, man, there's no way it's going to help you. Nobody can hear you out here. So he just throws rocks at him the whole time. And then it was right there where the kid and kind of realized like he's stuck in this hellhole, because after all that, he actually got chained to the leg during this whole time.
Yeah, because he's up on the building. Mm-hmm. He got out that window. He kicked out the
screen or whatever.
Screen window of the attic. And he's on top and he's just screaming, help, help, help. And you see Vincent D'Onofrio's character just saying, scream, go for it, just scream your eyeballs out because no one's going to help you. No one's coming here.
Yeah.
No one knows you're here. No one cares that you're here. And he just starts throwing rocks at him.
Yeah.
And just says, I'll give you a head start, run. You can run. You can try to get out of here. Just go ahead. But I'm, mm-hmm. He's just like, but you have nowhere to go.
Yeah. So
just playing this most fucked up mind games with this little kid.
Yeah. He's basically just kind of break the kid's spirit, pretty much having any kind of hope at all. And then pretty much after this scene, we get kind of like a speeded up kind of scene where the kid's actually a little older now. Vincent walks in with some more women. Basically what he does with these women, he catches them into his taxi. He brings them to the garage and he bangs on the door, and the kid has to run up to the door and unlock all these locks in the door. And he just basically grabs the girl by the head, and these girls are like screaming their asses off and stuff, screaming, screaming. He basically drags them into his semi-butcher room, and he goes in that butcher room, and then he pretty much has his way with them. He pretty much rapes them and kills them at the same time. All right, and he also records all of it too.
Yeah, with the camera inside a teddy bear.
Yeah. So, and the kid can hear it at the outside. So, during the movie, we don't actually see the full action happen, but no. It's filmed in a way where you see everything up until the actual him actually raping somebody and then killing them. Somebody, but you can hear it in the background and through the people's faces.
Yeah, it's blood curdling because it's kind of like puts you on edge because you're expecting to see it. It's panning mm-hmm. over to see it, but it doesn't really show it. And then you're just kind of you feel like your skin's about to come out because how horrible this person's probably getting hurt right there and there.
Yeah. And then there's this other scene pretty much where the Vincent, he's just driving around in his taxi or whatever, just does normal work too to make some money. And he picks up this father and son. And then he's driving, and he hears his son looking all depressed, and his father looking all pissed. And the father is basically telling the son hey, you're worth this piece of shit. you know, you're fucking, you suck at everything. And it's basically what's happening is it's bringing back memories to Vincent of what his father did to him. So this is when we first kind of get the flashback scenes of what happened to the Vincent's character during the whole movie. Basically, he had a an abusive father that would like pretty much, I guess he got sent off to live with his father and his mother or whatever.
Stepmother or something like
that. Yeah. So he kind of, there's like this flashback scene that comes a little bit later on in the film, which we'll just talk about right now, that pretty much like him and his brother, Vincent had like a brother or something. They were all going into the parents' house, and then the dad's all like a drunk guy, and pretty much the dad forces the Vincent's character, since he's like kind of a big guy and everything, to have sex with his own mother. All right, and he's having sex with his own mother and stuff because he's getting forced and everything. And basically, his character, like he's been forced to do this. He doesn't know what's going on, but he ends to like it. And his mom's like, just like, get off me after the dad leaves or whatever. And he just kind of drives him nuts and insane and makes him kind of like psycho in that way.
Yeah. And also you see like his brother watching the whole entire thing and
not helping out or anything.
Not helping out, but his brother's like being made to watch also. And you see like the violence of his father, and it's much like Vincent D'Onofrio's violence too.
Yeah.
And you see why they, why he escalates in calling them whores and sluts is because he's sees them as that.
Yeah, he sees all women as that because of his own experience he's had. And you know, it's, to me, like, this scene kind of like kind of sets it off, because that's, you know, people like that can happen if you grew up in like a very abusive household where things like that can happen. I mean, that's how a lot of, honestly, serial killers are made, you know, by abusive family or traumatic experiences in their life that's, that they can't get over. And then to compensate for that, they think that that's reality. Like, what he's doing, he thinks that's reality. That's, like, how the world works, because that's how he was grown. That's how it should be.
That's distorted thinking by his part, you know?
Because that's just the way it raised you. He doesn't know any, better. Doesn't know any different. So after kind of like he has all these memories and flashbacks, he goes back to the house. And basically what he wants to do is he wants to teach Rabbit to study the human anatomy, the human body and stuff. Because basically throughout this whole movie, pretty much he wants to make the rabbit like him. He basically told him like, hey, I don't want you to grow up to be an idiot. And I want you to grow up to be smart, kind of like an evolved human like I am. You know, that's what I kind of got out of the scene.
Yeah.
So basically he's studying all the stuff, and then Rabbit kind of fuses a couple of times, and then he just keeps freaking out most of the time. So he keeps freaking out on him and stuff, because basically Rabbit will, he'll take in the knowledge, but he refuses to kill because of the traumatic experience he probably saw with his mom.
Right, because he sees all those victims as his mother.
Yes.
But also he's nonetheless he's studying, but what he's studying is very important. Because he's studying anatomy.
Yeah, he's studying all parts of the human body.
Yeah.
So basically, like, Vincent's character wants him to study other parts of the body so Rabbit will know what to kill when he hunts his victim. Yeah,
knowing where to stab, knowing where to kill.
But Rabbit's just studying it because, you know, he, I guess, you know, something to do and to get interested in it, too. All right, so so some more time goes on where Vince is capturing some more girls and stuff, and there's this scene where Rabbit goes up to Vincent and basically just kind of like call him out on stuff, you know what I mean, kind of like, hey, why do you kill, like, why do you kill women and stuff? And that's pretty much where we get the whole, like, well, they're all, you finally find out that he's like, he thinks everybody's a whore, you know. He's pretty much saying them has all his victims are telling him the ones that kill people. And then he's asking like, why do you do all this stuff? And then he's like, well, because you make me. And then he's kind of like, that's a good answer. So pretty much we get more of the, like, the dominance and stuff. And he, Vincent also brings up, like, the food chain, too. It's like, where do you think you're at on the food chain to deny any of my requests? As in one of the scenes where he tried to give him, he's trying to pretty much teach him to be like him. So he gives him, like, a yearbook.
Yeah.
And pick out a victim. But Rabbit refuses to because he doesn't want to kill anybody. So what do you think about all this, Matt? Like, this guy, like, teaching somebody to be like him, teaching somebody to kill.
I think, for one thing, I think he's trying to find a, like, all along, like, when he first starts to show him things, and when he has, like, it goes back to that part where he, is in the car and he has the thoughts and memories from his father. And then he goes to the back to his house and he sees Rabbit and he starts, thinking kind of like a father son kind of deal going on there. Mm-hmm. And that's what he's been doing. He's kind of trying to show him things, there's things that he should, like he said, there are things that you should learn and I will teach you, the things that I know. And so he starts teaching him basically how to kill, what's the meaning of killing, how to hit the right spots on a human being to kill them,
Yeah, because they had this scene where they have a heart, a real life heart.
Yeah. And
basically he's telling Rabbit to guess what part of the heart is like a good stab part to kill him. And then he can't answer it over. And he's basically telling him, if you don't answer it, we have all day. And then he finally gets it. And then when he gets something right like that, Vincent gets really happy, And then one scene we get, which is a very interesting scene I could talk about a little bit, is when they're actually playing cards with the victim's IDs.
Yeah.
Because he's doing this weird lip motion stuff. Tell me a little bit about that.
Pardon me. Well, throughout the movie, he kind of does it with a lot of psychiatric drugs that he may have taken earlier in his life. Probably he may have had some kind of problems earlier. You see that he did, but he may have gone to an institution or a psychiatric ward for a little while because he has what is called like a tick jaw, to where he moves his jaw a whole lot and his lips and his tongue. And he also wipes his mouth a lot because he's slobbering. And that's because his mouth droops on one side and the drool will come out. So he has to like wipe it off. But that's, that's because the psychiatric drugs are kind of making his face do that. And he also gets like dry mouth. So he gets a lot of saliva.
Yeah. And so basically they taught each other to play this game where they would pick it, kind of like playing cards with an ID. And then one of them would say a name and then they would guess like the weight, the birthday and the town. And then what the person kind of complained about to him before he killed her. So it's pretty fucked up kind of game because he remembers all his victims pretty much by doing this kind of game and stuff.
Yeah, each one is special too.
Yeah. And then like he's pretty much telling.
It's like a trophy. It's like he's
new. Yeah. It's kind of like a trophy too. And he also said to the rabbit that's, the reason he's doing that is because it's very important to keep records. Which right. I always thought was like a weird trait for. I mean, that's pretty much a destined trait for all types of serial killers that you read out throughout history and stuff. They all have something from a victim that they keep for like a trophy and stuff. And that was just basically his was like keeping their IDs plus keeping all the articles of people, of the missing people articles that they found in the newspaper. All right. And also too, he also sees there's also a couple. Scenes where you see the police kind of not figuring out where, where these missing peoples are coming from. They have no lead
on the news
because he's taking everybody by a taxi. And the Vincent's character is very happy about this news too.
He thinks he's uncatchable. He's unstoppable.
So some progression out the movie. Vince is very, very big on kind of getting the rabbit to kind of like to be like him, to do his deed. So basically he's forcing him in this one scene to take a knife and look at the yearbook and pick out a victim for him. Because basically Vincent thinks Rabbit's judgment is flawed of not killing somebody because he hasn't had a taste of a woman. He hasn't had sex with a woman. He hasn't killed a woman yet. He thinks that once the rabbit actually does the act of killing a woman and having sex with her, that he will be automatically more like him. So he's like desperately trying to get Rabbit to pick out a victim for him. So they basically go through the school book and first Rabbit denies it, then he gets pissed off and he pretty much makes him pick out a girl. And then Vincent actually goes and finds the girl and gets her in the trunk.
Yeah, brings her home.
Brings her home. So when he does that, Rabbit's on the floor just reading out through his books and stuff.
He's underneath the table.
Yeah, underneath the table just reading his books and stuff, being all, very scared. And the rabbit, pretty much what he looks like, to give you guys like a hint, like he's he's older now. He's not 9. He's like, he has to be at least like 18 or something at this time, maybe a little bit younger, but he's like full, almost bones, because he barely eats anything, very weak looking. Kind of looks like somebody in like a concentration camp or something, like very, You know, just like a guy that you would think would be chained up and doesn't have a lot of, you know, force behind him or anything. Having trouble over there, man?
Yeah, I have the dogs. but yeah, he does look like he does. Shit. No. No. Okay. He does appear skinny. He appears malnourished, like starving. Like he always says. I mean, you saw him like at the beginning of the movie where he's just gulping down the leftovers that he leaves him, and it's always like cereal or something.
Yeah, yeah. He pretty much eats over like leftovers. Like I was saying before, he only has the leftovers of what Vincent's character is eating. So he's very weak, very can barely do anything. So basically, Vincent he pretty much puts the girl into one of the I guess brooms that he has in his house. That's kind of like a weird looking room. There's a bed there, there's a drawer there, and there's this weird chair with like some Christmas lights on it and stuff. Very creepy kind of room.
And then he has like an anatomy anatomy figure, mm-hmm. Or model yeah. figure of a human being, and anatomy pictures on the wall. So it's kind of like it shows that he too has studied anatomy, mm-hmm. and where to kill. So he knows.
I also
which
think
is really crazy.
I also think he kind of designed this room for Rabbit. So when Rabbit matures in his way, this will be his permanent room. Mm-hmm. So because Vincent was staying in a different room. It was just one little bed and him sleeping there with his boxers on the whole time.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So basically he goes up to Rabbit and be like, hey, she's ready. And then Rabbit's like not saying anything. He's scared. He doesn't want to do anything. He doesn't want to do it at all. And he's basically saying like, yeah, he sits down. He's basically like, hey, I know it's hard your first time and stuff, but you know, it gets easier or whatever. So basically he drags him into the room, and then, they stare at each other or whatever. And then, he locks him up in there. Okay.
And he gives him the knife.
Mm-hmm. And then, which is kind of crazy about this, an earlier scene that we didn't go over was kind of like the first time he was kind of teaching Rabbit about this knife that he gave it to him. Vincent actually brings home some drunk girl, all right?
Right.
And the drunk girl just all around, you know, just acting up like everything's okay. I think he just paid her for like a hooker or something like that. I'm not sure. Basically, she's just complaining that she has to pee the whole time and blah, blah, blah. So they bring her into the, I guess, the kill room. And they're just both just looking at her like crazy, and she's just saying stuff. Vince is basically like, hey, say everything's going to be okay. She's like, okay, I'll say everything's going to be okay. You guys are letting me pee or whatever. And, you know, so she starts smoking too, and he doesn't like that either. So he basically says, hey, grab my hand. So she grabs Vince's hand, he lifts up, and he cuts her right in the throat. And that's the first time that Rabbit's actually seen a girl die right in front of him.
Yeah.
So that's the significance of the knife that he actually gives Rabbit when he wants him to kill this girl that he picked out from the school book. So basically, Vincent says, hey, remember what we talked about? If you don't do this, I'm going to have to do it for you.
Right. Yeah.
So basically, he closes the door, and then the girl's scared. The guy's kind of scared, too. They start talking a little bit, and basically they figure out, like, the Rabbit says, like, hey, I don't want to hurt you and stuff, but this guy's kind of making me want to do it and stuff. And she's kind of all like, you know, basically just kind of figure out any way to survive in a way, you know, kind of feeling sympathy for the guy, too, because she could tell, like, this is probably her only chance to, like, maybe escape is through this guy. So she's kind of giving up herself, being like, hey, you can have me any kind of way you want to. Just, you know.
Just please don't kill
yeah.
me.
Kind of getting to his head, too. Like, kind of like he wants to be a savior. And he was like, yeah, yeah, I want to save you and stuff.
Yeah.
And then, during this whole time, Vincent's in his room looking so pissed because he doesn't hear any screams or whatever. So he turns on the TV, and all this time he's getting pissed. And basically, when the girl's name is Angie. And then when Angie and the Rabbit were kind of like in the action where she's like, hey, you never been with the girl. I'll show you what it's like or whatever. She's all touching up on each other. And then the guy, Vincent, walks in. And then and then the Rabbit kind of freaks out and everything. Because basically, while she was touching him and stuff, Rabbit had the knife right there. And basically, right when he walked in and stuff, he got nervous and got scared. And he stabbed her right in the stomach. And then he's like screaming to Vince to get the fuck out. Get out of here. Get out of here. And then that's when you hear him go back to the couch. And then you see Rabbit drag the girl into the burial ground. Because what they did with their victims, they bury them underground.
Underneath the house, kind of, or in like in a shaft area that.
Yeah, while using salt too, right?
Yeah, lime, yeah, to cover the smell.
Yep. So after that, basically, Rabbit comes out all bloodied on him and stuff, and basically tells Vincent, like, hey, I want to hunt. And Vincent's really happy about this. So Vincent pretty much gives him, you know, you see the scene where Rabbit's cleaning up to himself, like washing himself off and pretty much thinking like, oh, this guy's turned, like he's killed this girl and he's ready to come full-blown serial killer now. So basically he gets all dressed up, all ready to go, and they go drive to the town. But one of the scenes is when he's about to get into the taxi, he's having flashbacks of him, young man, in the taxi and stuff, freaking out. Kind of hearing his screams like stuff before that. So it's taking him a while to get into the taxi. And then he goes into the taxi and stuff, and they're all driving around the town, kind of seeing what's going on. And basically Vincent's saying, like, you know, what's your pick and everything? What's your pick? And then a crazy scene was he's saying, like, oh, well, if you can't find anything, we'll just watch your first kill.
Yes.
And tell us a little bit about that, Matt.
His first kill, or?
No, well, like, because he didn't know the Rabbit, remember, he didn't know that his first kill was being recorded.
Right. Rabbit starts freaking out and saying, no.
That's my private
collection.
That's
private. That's my private thing. And he says, no, I want to watch it with you. You know, that's important. You know, mm-hmm. It's important to watch it. You know, he just keeps saying, we're going to watch it. And
yeah. So he's basically like, we're going to go by the school. If we don't find anything, we're going to go back and watch your first kill. So they go by the school, and then they see a cop car drive by. Mm-hmm. And the guy's just saying, you know, duck down. And, you know, I'm going to go through my papers or whatever. And basically why he did that, it's kind of like where he stopped, he saw a mirror.
Yes.
All right? And then what would that mirror, what did it say?
In red, it says, help.
Yeah.
On the side of the taxi.
Yeah. So it said, help me on the side of the taxi. And the Vincent character sees it and he gets so pissed that he punches the Rabbit and saying, why did you do this? So he jumps out of the taxi and wipes it all down and stuff. And he basically gets so disappointed, very disappointed in Rabbit and stuff. And then from there, he pretty much realizes, like, hey, you didn't kill that girl, did you? You know, you didn't kill that Angie girl and stuff. She's still in the house. You didn't finish what you started or whatever. So they basically drive back to the house and stuff, and Vince is kind of like, you know, getting pissed off at the Rabbit guy, saying, why aren't you listening to me? Why aren't you listening to me? What the fuck is wrong with you and shit, you know? Just, like, going crazy. And he jumps into the house, and what does he do? He's like, oh, Angie!
He, like, takes off his coat and...
Yeah, ready to go.
Ready to go. Doesn't he, like, he runs into the... He runs into
the body area.
Yeah, the kill room and where the hatch is to go into where all the bodies are. And Angie's there with a flashlight and jars to piss in.
Yeah, that. And then she also got like a box cutter knife that Rabbit found off one of the victim's purses that he kept.
Yes. And so he gave it to her. And so Vincent D'Onofrio, you see Rabbit, like, frantically.
Yeah, trying to open the door because he got locked out.
And because Vincent D'Onofrio, like, locks him out. And so you see him get a crowbar and cram open that door and run. And then you see William Dafoe. And, Greg, what happens?
Pretty much, that girl slices him right on the, what is that?
Achilles tendon,
which had to suck.
But
the guy deserved it.
You see it split too,
and he's screaming all kinds of bloody hell.
That's like one of the only gore parts of that.
Yeah. Well, we did see a couple cut up girl bodies.
Yeah.
But overall, this movie wasn't like gore fest. It was more like
psychological
fest. A lot of screaming, a lot of like torturing, like sound effects, and they did it very good for like making it feel like very realistic. You know, with the torturing of the girls and stuff. And also, too, during this whole time, Rabbit's just trying to, like, find a way to end his door. Basically, he goes into the back of the taxi, grabs a crowbar, and bashes open the door. And when he does that, he runs right into the kill room, too, and he's trying to tackle down Vincent's character. And then Vincent kind of gets on top of him and stuff and starts punching the fuck out of this guy. And then he kind of looks over, and he sees Angie, and he thinks she's dead. Mm. All right? Because then Vincent kind of gets tired, too, because he's kind of a fat guy and stuff, so he's getting a little tired.
Yeah,
he's hurting from the cut on his ankle, too. But what happens basically is Rabbit kind of turns around, puts him into a choke, And he has a knife with him, too. And he's like, did you kill her? Did you kill her? Did you kill her? And Vincent's like, yeah, she's dead or whatever. He's like, and he's basically looking at him and saying, like, you're not going to do anything. You know, you're not going to do this. You're not going to do it. And he, bam.
He gets him right.
He stabs him with this knife.
All the way up
from his chin all the way up to his face. So this guy, the Vincent character, is gone for. And then when he did that, you actually could see the Angie character waking up a little bit. Stuff. So, yeah, what did you think about this scene? Pretty intense, huh?
That was an intense. That was just a complete, crazy mind trip right there. You know, I think she got that from her father.
Yeah.
That was a really surreal scene.
Yeah.
Because you just like you don't realize that you think she's dead. Like, yeah. And then it's like a snap. She snaps forward, and you see like what he's done, and you know, you don't. I don't think. And like what my thing is, what I think what also what is really neat is that in the movie we talked to, you know, we're talking about there's not a lot of gore, there's not a lot of things to be seen, but Rabbit, as he's growing up, he doesn't see a lot of the murder scenes at all. So it's kind of like we're seeing this through Rabbit's point of view.
Yeah, like I said before, the first murder he witnessed was the drunk girl when Vincent slit her throat.
And then you actually see that the slitting of her throat, you know, but
now something I forgot to explain was Rabbit actually kept Angie alive during this whole thing. And how he did it was, remember, because he studied the anatomy body.
Yeah.
He actually cut her in a way that she wouldn't die, but she would be sick, but she'd still be alive after it. So during all that study and stuff taught him how to know her body. And that's what he told her, too. Like, hey, I know your body better than, you know, even you do. So basically, after Vincent's character died and everything, he basically, you know, like, you see the Angie girl and you see him kind of resting or whatever. And you also see all these papers spread out in front of the desk, too, like all kinds of bills and all kinds of notes and letters and stuff like that. And then we get this scene where we see a car or we see the scene of this house, this rich looking house and stuff. And it's to point out one of the things that made Rabbit kind of snap a little bit and kind of like feel like there's even more no hope was a little earlier on in the movie. Vincent actually shows like, hey, look, your father and everything, they moved on. He got a new house. He got new everything. He has a new family. He's not looking for you anymore. So it was one of the things that kind of made Rabbit like even more despair, more obedient. You know what I mean? More like a, like to do what this guy wants to. So basically he finds a letter about this too. And he goes, and he actually goes to his dad's house, and he sees like his dad's new wife. He sees a dog. You know, he even finds out the dad has a kid and everything. And he's all talking about like, "Hey, I always wanted a dog."
New brother, yeah.
He didn't even know he had a brother or anything.
Yeah, he's like, "I have a brother," you know. And he's also like, "You know, you're gonna buy me a dog." But another part that was really interesting that I caught the part, but I didn't really realize it until the end. Oh, wait, go ahead and go.
Well, I was going to be like, you know, Rabbit is over there, like, you know, basically shocked about this house he's looking at and stuff because he's been in captivity this whole time. And basically he goes up to his dad and gives him this letter and be like, why did you do this? Why did you give your brother this letter and stuff? And basically what the dad did was he was the brother of the Vincent. He gave Vincent basically a letter of what them two look like and money to pay for him to get rid of his wife and his kid this whole time.
Right.
And so I guess because the dad thought Vincent was going to kill both the mom and the kid. I don't think he ever expected the kid to actually survive because Vincent couldn't kill the child because the child wasn't a female. Because Vincent's character could only kill females because he thought all females were whores and everything. So that's why it was easy for him to kill the wife, but it wasn't easy for him to kill the kid. And then over time, that's when Vincent wanted to train him to be the killer.
Yeah, and kind of had sympathy on him.
Yeah.
You know? And one part, which is, I don't know if it's when he was a kid or when he got older, but there's one part where he says, he talks about him like his father said at the beginning, you know, he says, because he tells him, look out for your mother. And he said, and then his, you know, the son said, yeah. And he said, in one ear and out the other. And Vincent D'Onofrio's character says the same thing. And so you get a hint that they were brothers, you know.
Yeah, through that one line that he said at the beginning.
Because he kind of looks at him strange, you know, the kid, Rabbit, looks at him kind of strangely, you know, because it's, you know, it's the same phrase as his brother.
Yeah, so then when we find out it's his brother and stuff, he basically tells his wife to get upstairs and stuff because, and then you see kind of like Rabbit kind of shy and stuff, and basically the brother confesses like, oh, what the hell are you going to do? You're not going to say anything. You're not going to do anything. Yeah. You know, get the fuck out of my house. And then basically the wife comes over. And she is like shocked about all this stuff because
she's overhearing. She's listening.
She's listening into the whole conversation and stuff. And basically what happens is, the fuck is that?
The dog.
Oh, dogs are going crazy. So basically she grabs the guy and throws him down and stuff. And oh, no, she tackles the guy. But then the guy grabs the girl and throws her down. It looks like he's about to rape her and shit. It's like randomly. Because yeah, I guess it's like part of his family thing is coming out of him too, right, at that scene. Yeah,
because you see him start to become, you know, very brutal, very mean.
And then Rabbit starts having all these flashbacks about all these women he's seen over his course of his pretty much his entire life of Vincent bringing in all these girls and stuff. He just snaps and gets like this like piece of like glass thing and starts smashing over his dad's head until his dad dies. And then we get like this really quiet scene and basically like she's like, telling him to go home.
She starts she walks around and starts smashing things in the house.
Yeah.
And
she realized like her husband was a murderer pretty much.
Yeah, like her husband was a murderer and ruined his son's life and was about to ruin her life. And his father was about to kill his wife and he flipped out and killed him to save her life, and she saved his by telling him to run. And get away. So
yeah, then she called the cops and be like, "Hey, some guy just ran into my house and killed my husband." And shit. Yeah. So then after that, we get the scene of Rabbit just, you know, lost in life and doesn't even know what's going on. And just goes back to that murder house that he was staying in this whole time and just walks right in, opens the garage door, walks right in, closes the garage door, and that's the end of the movie.
End of the movie.
So very intense movie. Kind of shows you. Kind of like the ugliness that what can happen if you grew up in kind of like a disturbing family and you have just so much stuff and, you know, it just like how the human mind can kind of like just be so twisted and stuff to live life like that.
An abusive, and it shows like what can happen in a abusive relation, you know, family abusive relationship where, you know, whether it being physical or emotional or verbally abusive, you know, it messes up people. Mm-hmm. It really does. And they made a, you know, this went to the far extreme of abuse, you know, cause it's, you know, he's being made to have sex with his mother and, you know, it just degrades him and, you know, he just feels like he's worthless and he becomes this kill, you know, he just becomes.
And another crazy part I thought was the dad of Rabbits, you know, he basically pretty much paid off his brother to come and kidnap and kill his wife and stuff. You know, what if he never got caught of doing that? What if he just kept sending his wives, different wives that he just got bored of, whatever, off to Rabbit?
To
him,
off to his brothers.
Off to his brother and stuff, you know.
Well, I think maybe she was rich to begin with. And he wanted to get them out of the way so he can get remarried and get rich.
Yeah, get the money for them and stuff. So very, like I said, very ugly traits of all these humans coming out in this movie. So overall, like, what did you think of the movie, Matt?
Overall, I would give it an 8.
An 8? Yeah. I'm going to bet about the same way, too. A good 8. I mean, it's definitely a different style horror movie. It's more of a psychological, like, real life, like,
Thriller
in a way, and kind of getting into a mind of a serial killer that's been abused, you know, younger and stuff, and how he can kind of like ruin a kid's life and try to make somebody like him, but also shows a will of a kid to not cave in to a lot of this stuff because of his mother and stuff. But it also shows the kid is also lost in life too, because, you know, at the end of the movie he has to go back to the house because that's all he has left is a house and a taxi. So we're not even sure if, you know,
where he goes
in his life. Is he going to eventually start hurting people, or is he just going to help? Yeah. The kid's just so lost in life.
Yeah, and are the cops going to, like, find him? Or, you know,
is so, it, A lot of unanswered questions, but overall, great movie.
Just become a crazy old man. That's what he's going to be.
Yeah, yeah. Watching the TVs. And
so stuff. Definitely watch this movie. Definitely pick it
yeah.
up.
Yeah, pick it up, everybody. Like I said, Jennifer
Lynch. If you like David Lynch, I mean, it's not incredibly his style, but there are some shots that are like his. But also, it's just a really good, you know, it's a good boost for his daughter to come out and do something like this. And really, I'm really excited to see her next film.
Yeah, yeah. So she will be coming out with some more films later on, and I definitely recommend everybody to check it out too. She definitely has a nice filming style, very very realistic, very just a lot of realistic kind of stuff too. Like, and that's some stuff I kind of look for in my horror movies. It kind of makes you cringeworthy, you know. It makes you watch it and, like, you know, it doesn't necessarily scare you for shock value, but it makes you disturbed. It makes you have an uneasy feeling about yourself.
Yeah, these are the real monsters, you know. Yes. These are real ones that these aren't like, you know, things that hide underneath your bed or mm-hmm. you know,
these are things that can come and get
fingers.
You.
These are the real guys that may get you someday, sometime, you know.
Yep, they can come get you. So, everybody, that'll wrap this up. But let's hear some words from Jennifer Lynch herself on the movie Chained and on Walking Dead and Teen Wolf.
Pretty good. I'm Greg. Nice to meet you. Really big fan of your Chained movie.
Oh, right on.
Like, I picked it out, like, randomly, and I watched it. I was like, this is crazy.
Oh, good.
Like, I got, like, I'll probably take that one.
All right, right on. And it's Greg, right?
Yes.
All right.
What made you come up with that idea? I just thought it was so creative.
Oh, thank you. You know, I'm all about the human monster.
Yeah.
So, you know, trying to figure out why someone might do something terrible.
Yeah.
And people being put in positions where they can't just walk away.
Yeah.
So that's how that happened.
Yeah, and how did you get him to do that? Because he was, wasn't he playing a detective the whole time during the show? And he actually, the first time you actually see him has the person he's trying to get.
Well, it's, you know, what's funny is that he's, you know, I sent him the script, and the next day he called me and said,
wow, cool.
"Want to make a movie?"
Yeah.
And it's just the nicest guy in the world. He just ask. The worst they can say is no.
Yeah.
You know.
I just thought it was great.
Thank you so much.
I was like, because I like that kind of like greediness and kind of the realism.
Yeah.
Thing. That's what I kind of try to do my movies a bit like.
Nice.
So. I thought that
authenticity,
was awesome.
Man.
Yeah,
like it's really happening.
And then your episodes of The Walking Dead are awesome.
Oh, thank you.
How'd you jump on that?
Believe it or not, I was shooting some episodes of Teen Wolf.
Oh, okay.
And some of the people on Teen Wolf said, you should do Walking Dead. And I said, yeah, I wish.
Yeah.
And then I got a phone call, and they said, we know people over there. And then Walking Dead called me. So, believe it or not, Walking Dead and Teen Wolf.
So, we just heard some words from Jennifer Lynch over there about this movie and stuff. We're about to wrap it up over here, too. I want to thank my good old guest over here, Matt Bloodbeard Shope.
Yes.
And let you guys know, like, sorry, we took a little bit of hiatus during the June month and when he released one podcast, but July, we got a lot of stuff coming up for you guys for July. Obviously, we just did this podcast over here with Chained. Up next is going to be the Killer Instant Podcast, where I'm going to be talking about my trip from North Carolina and the Asheville and all the haunted places I got to visit and all the stories and stuff. Very interesting stuff there. We're also going to have another Faces of Fear review with my good old boy Sobek. And we're going to be reviewing the movie Dungeon of Horror, the 1974 version. Very crazy movie. Also, too, I'm going to give a little special out for you guys, too, since we didn't get to give a lot of podcasts in June. We also have another podcast coming up. It's going to be Jaws, the famous original Jaws movie. And actually, I have another special guest on that one. Will be the one, the only... My birth mom, Kim Klein, will be on the podcast talking about Jaws. So you guys are going to hear all kinds of stories. Very, very interesting movie when you do one with your mom. Very, very fun podcast.
Yeah, I think that would be really interesting.
So basically, you guys are going to hear some backstories of me because I used to live in Miami, Florida, where we had a lot of beaches and stuff, where we had not necessarily too much sharks. But we did have a lot of crocodiles. Do you have a little bit about my crocodile
alligator.
Stories?
Alligator.
Yeah, alligators, whatever. So you have a little bit about my alligator stories. But we do hear a very special story of when I was 4 years old on a boat and my mom did catch a shark. So we got that coming up. And also, too, we also have another podcast coming up. We're going to be reviewing Dead Snow with two special guests. My good old boy over here, Matt, the Bloodbeard Show, and Sobek. And also, too, next month, we're going to have a very special Killer Instant podcast with the same two dudes, Sobek and Matt. And we're going to be talking about everything in horror. And basically, you guys are going to get a full biography of what our favorite horror movies are, what are some stuff you guys should check out. And we did this whole podcast, and we were drinking the whole time, so it's definitely a good one to check out. So, for me, J.K. Klein, and for my good old friend over here, Matt Bloodbeard Shope, we are out.